Now we'll study about nuclear fusion. We already studied that a fusion reaction takes place when two or more lightweight nuclei combine and produce a middleweight nuclei, which are close to those nuclei which are having very high binding energies. And here to understand this fusion, let's consider a reaction in which we consider a nuclei A, which is having mass number 5, and another nuclei B, say, which is having mass number 6. And if we consider a reaction in which two nuclei of A fuse with the three nuclei of B, and it gives a nuclei C. So, you can see the total number of nucleons will be 28. So, C would be lying somewhere here, which is the nuclei C with mass number 28. If say A is having binding energy per nucleon EA and B is having binding energy per nucleon EB and the binding energy per nucleon of C is EC, here we can see that binding energy per nucleon of C is higher than that of A and B. So, certainly it is more stable, so some amount of energy delta E is released, which we term as fusion energy. And this can be easily calculated by the same method we have done in case of calculation of fusion energy. So, here we can directly write the energy released in our reaction is, this can be directly given as delta E is equals to amount of energy which is released in formation of nucleus C will be 28 EC. But some energy is used in splitting up these nuclei A and B. So, we need to subtract it, that will be 10 EA plus 18 EB, because 10 nucleons will be produced when 10 EA energy will be supplied to A, and 18 nucleons will be produced when 18 EB energy is supplied to this. So, this is the total Q value of the reaction, and the same energy can also be calculated by using the method of mass defect as 2MA plus 3MB minus MC multiplied by C square, or 931.5 MeV. Both of these methods will result the same value, because here we are calculating directly by binding energy per nucleon for the nuclei involved in the reaction, and here we are calculating the energy released by using mass effect. But there is one more important point to be understood here, is these nuclei will fuse to produce nuclei C only when these are brought very close to each other. So, here we can write down a note also, that fusion reactions start when nuclei are brought very close to each other at separation which is of the order of 10 to the power minus 14 meter or less, because at separation, more than this, nuclear forces won't come in picture, so no fusion will start. And at this separation, nuclei can be brought only when the temperature of the sample is excessively high, so that their kinetic energy becomes too large, that the closest approach separation will be very less. Here we can write, this happens only when sample temperature is very high, which is of the order of 10 to power 6 to 10 to power 7 Kelvin. Because at this temperature, nuclei will have very high kinetic energy, so when they collide, their closest distance of approach will become less than this. So, unless the temperature is excessively high, fusion reactions won't start. That's why these reactions are called thermonuclear reactions. Because to start the nuclear reaction, to just appearance of nuclear force, the suppression should be very small. For this, we need to raise the temperature to a very high extent, and to control such a high temperature within a confined region itself is a typical process. That's why fusion reactions involve a lot of logistics in the execution part. That's why these are called thermonuclear reactions. And when at such a high temperature, all these nucleons are in a very high kinetic energy state. These are all ionized states of these elements, and such ionized states of these elements at high temperature is termed as plasmic material, in which the fusion reaction starts.